The role of 8257 DML controller is basically, as its name suggests, it is DMA, that is direct memory access. So if the memory need of the 8085 need to be accessed by the external device, then there is a need of DMA controller. What it does is basically a microprocessor is there, and this microprocessor is not having you can say the whatever speed of microprocessor is there, that is not compatible with the external device. Whatever external device is connected to the microprocessor, that external device will not be having the similar speed of operation as. So there is a difference in, okay, there is a requirement of a medium which can, this is microprocessor and this is external device. Okay, so, and this is slow and this is fast. So as microprocessor is fast and it is slow, so to communicate between external device that is slow and microprocessor that is fast, basically it is not an efficient manner of data transfer basically. So even if the microprocessor is fast, as the slow device, the external device is slow, the data transmission will only be taking place in slow mode only, so that the speed of microprocessor will be limited. Okay, so that is not an efficient way to transfer the data. So basically for that we will be requiring a medium or intermediate component. Okay, so that intermediate component will be 8257, that is called DMA controller. So here DMA stands for direct memory access. Okay, so direct memory access means, so microprocessor is having a memory, okay, and from this memory a data to be transferred to the external device or external device to a memory. So to communicate between these two components, memory of the microprocessor and external device, to communicate between these two the devices, the use of a DMA controller is basically exist. Okay, so here what DMA basically does is it acquires the control bus, data bus and address bus of microprocessor, and based on the requirement of the data, based on the requirement of external device, DMA controller itself controls all the buses and make sure the data can be transferred from memory to the external device. Okay, this DMA controller basically designed by Intel. Okay, and it transfers data at fastest speed. So with respect to the data transfer, this is the fastest way to transfer the data. So it gives fastest data transfer rate. Okay, and next point is it allows the device to transfer the data directly to or from the memory without any interference of the CPU. That means the microprocessor will not be interfering in the data transfer. The directly DMA controller will be able to transfer the data from the memory or to the memory. Okay, so memory of the microprocessor, that will be data transmission can be taken place. Okay, so basically the data memory of microprocessor we are dealing with means the memory available to the CPU. So CPU is there, CPU is consist of different components. In that, one component is microprocessor and one component is memory. Okay, so the data that can be transmitted from the memory to external device, that will be basically facilitated by this DMA controller. Okay, so using DMA controller, the device requests the CPU. So how does it works basically? So what this DMA controller does is it requests the CPU. First of all, the DMA controller will request to the CPU to hold the data address and control buses. That means first of all, DMA will try to get a send a request to the CPU like you need to hold accessing or using these buses. So the device is free. So the device is free to transfer data directly from or to the memory. Okay. So basically, if the data address and control buses is free from the interference of microprocessor, okay, then these buses will be free to transfer the data from the memory of the CPU basically. Okay, so the DMA data transfer is initiated only after receiving the HLDA signal from the CPU. So this we will be seeing like once the DMA has sent a request and microprocessor or CPU has acknowledged that request, and that acknowledgement will be in the form of HLDA. Okay, so this is hold acknowledgement. So CPU will provide hold acknowledgement, or the microprocessor will provide hold acknowledgement. Once the hold acknowledgement signal is received by the DMA controller, the DMA control starts transferring the data from the memory by using the data address and control buses to the external device. Okay. So next point, we will see how a DMA operation is performed. Okay. So here, in case of a DMA operation, there are following steps basically. So the first step initially when the device has to send the data between the device and the memory. So this here device is basically the external device. This is the external device. First of all, the device that we need to communicate with the memory of the CPU. So that device will send a DMA request to the DMA controller. Okay. So then another DMA controller, and here the external device. Okay, so when the external device need to access the memory of CPU, what it does is this request will be basically called DMA request. This is called DRQ. Okay, so external device will send a DMA request to the DMA. Okay, this is the first step. Next, the DMA controller sends the hold request to the CPU. So once the DMA request is received by the DMA controller that is sent from the external device, then DMA controller will send a request to the CPU. Okay, so this send request will be called as hold request. It is sending a request so that it the CPU can hold, or the microprocessor can hold the accessing of data control and address buses. So this is hold request. It is called HRQ, hold request. So this DMA will be sending hold request to CPU. So once this CPU receives this HRQ, that is hold request, what it does is by completing its task, it will remove the control of buses basically, and it will remove the buses control, and then once it has removed the control to the buses, this CPU or the microprocessor will send a signal to the DMA controller. It will send a signal back. So this signal will be basically called the hold acknowledge, because it was hold signal was requested by DMA. So in acknowledgement to this hold signal, the hold acknowledgement will be sent. So it is called hold HLDA, hold acknowledgement. So it is called hold acknowledgement. Okay, so hold acknowledgement will be sent to DMA. So once this DMA has received the hold acknowledgement signal, now the CPU is working in hold state. So CPU will be in a hold state, and if it is in hold state, that means it will not be controlling the data bus, control bus, and address bus. So at that time, once the hold acknowledgement has been received with the DMA controller, that means the DMA will be hold sole control will be the controller of basically the data bus, address, okay, and control bus. All will be controlled by the DMA controller itself. Okay, DMA controller itself. Okay. once it DMA controller is able to control this process, it will be performing the memory or data transfer from the memory of the CPU to the input output device or whatever device it is. Okay, so this is how we will be performing the operations with this DMA controller. Okay, so this is how the DMA controller works. These are some features of 8257, that is a DMA controller. In terms of features, if we say, so here it has four channels which can be used over four input output devices. That means the DMA controller has four channels. So this is like four channels will be there. Through these four channels, the input output devices can send request and take the data out and in. Okay, so these four channels are there, means four signals, four input output devices can communicate at a time, can send data to 8257. Okay, so this is four input output device can connect basically or send a request to the DMA controller. So four channels are there. Okay, each channel has 16 bit address and 14 bit counter. Okay, so each channel that is having, that will be having, each channel will be having 16 bit address. Okay, so it will be having a 16 bit address. Okay, so address will be of 16 bit, and it will be having 14 bit counter. So basically this counter is for like how many bytes of data need to be transferred, that will be decided and stored in this 14 bit counters only. Okay, so to a fixed value of data transfer, the DMA will stop itself and further it will not be sending any data. So that is basically controlled by the counter. Each channel can transfer data up to 64 and transfer the data up to, okay, so here each channel can transfer data up to 64 KB. okay, up to 64 KB each channel can transfer. So if four KB can be transferred, and each channel can be programmed independently. So each channel can be programmed independently. So based on the requirement and what are the applications, how we need to connect, we can program the each channels. Okay, each channel can perform read, write transfer, and verify the transfer. So it can read or write, and also it can verify whether particular operation has been taken place or not. So either read or write operation has taken place or not, it that particular amount of data has or not. Okay, it generates mark signal. So here it is saying like it will be generating a mark signal to peripheral device or external device if 128 byte of data have been sent. If 128 byte of data have been sent or transferred, then the DMA controller will generate a signal that will be considered as the mark signal. Okay, so mark signal is basically one of the pin input, one of the pin output of the DMA controller that will indicate like the 128 byte of data have been transferred. Okay, it requires a single phase clock. So DMA controller will be requiring a single phase clock, and its frequency ranges from 150 हर्ट्ज टू 3 मेगा हर्ट्ज ओके एंड इट कैन ऑपरेट इन टू डिफरेंट मोड्स सो वन इज मास्टर मोड अनदर वन इज स्लेव मोड सो दीज टू मोड्स आर देयर वी विल सी दैट लेटर दिस इज द पिन डायग्राम ओके दिस इज द पिन डायग्राम ऑफ 8257 डीएमए कंट्रोलर here we can see like total starting with 1 there are total 40 pins and this pin at the left bottom is your ground okay and your basically with respect to that we will see like whatever input we are providing that will be in the form of request to the DMA controller so here is like request are basically because it is four channel so it will be receiving the request from the external device by four different so these are like DMA request DRQ 0 1 2 3 so four these are channels so these are pins that are indicating the channels like the four pins are there So these four external devices, input devices can communicate, send a request to the DMA controller. And these requests like D0, D1, D2, D3, it has some preference also. So there are some preference. There are some preference to DRQ signals. We'll see that later. Okay. So once the DRQ signal has been received from the external device by the DMA controller, it will send hold signal to the microprocessor. Okay. So it will send hold signal to the microprocessor. Okay. And if that hold signal it has sending or hold signal or we call it hold request. So hold request is basically HRQ. Hold request is there. So this is the hold signal that will be an output signal from the DMA controller that will be going to the microprocessor. Okay, microprocessor hold pin. It will go to microprocessor hold pin. And once the microprocessor has stopped the control of different buses, it will send HLDA. So HLDA will be output signal for the microprocessor, but it will be input signal to the DMA controller. So once this HLDA have been received by the DMA controller, now the DMA controller can control the data and address and control buses of the microprocessor. And it can now either read or write. So if it is reading, okay, if it is reading with the input-output devices, so it will be for input-output read. This is input-output write. This is memory read, memory write. So if it is reading the data from the input output devices, it is considered as reading from the input output devices. Okay. So IOW, that means input output write. So if it is writing the data from the input output devices, then that pin will be activated. Okay. In case of memory and read and memory write, so it will be a input signal. So it will be providing like the DMA controller is transferring the data from the memory or accepting the data to the memory. Okay. This mark signal, it is pin number 5. Mark signal, we have seen this mark signal is basically used when 28 bytes of data have been transferred, then mark signal will be okay. And here, D acknowledgement. So whatever request have been sent, that is device request that have been sent. So to acknowledge the devices, there are four different acknowledgement. So if the 8257 is ready to make transaction based transfer data between the memory to the input output devices or the external device, it will acknowledge the device by using these acknowledgement four acknowledgement signals 0 1 2 3, and here pin number 31 will be giving you out the VCC. Okay, so these are different bits, like data bits, so it can transfer the 8 bit data. So D0, D1, D2, D3, D4, D5, D6, D7 as given by this. Okay, so addresses are there, A0 to A7 up to here. Address bus are there. Okay, so there are the different pins of 8 to 57. And this is the architecture. This is the architecture of 8 to 57. So in this 8 to 57, there are four different channels. So these are channel 0. Okay, so one channel will be having a DRQ request, that is DRQ0. That means it can accept data from the external device. Next one is, it will be giving acknowledgement to the external device. The next channel 1 is there, channel 2 is there, channel 3 is there. So channel 1, channel 2, channel 1, channel 2, channel 3. So for all different channels, it will be having a 16-bit address. Address and 14 bit counter each of the channel will be having. Okay, and it can accept the DRQ request and it will give a device acknowledgement. Okay, and there is a priority resolver. Okay, so this priority resolver will prioritize whether the request from which channel will be considered first, and if all the four channels have given the signal or the request, then which signal need to be processed first. So that is decided by the priority encoder. One block is control logic and mode set registers. So here this is another block that will basically set the logic and the control of the DMA function, either it is working in master mode or slave mode, either it is how it is going to transfer the taking the data, how it will be accepting the you can say permission to access the buses, basically that is decided by this control logic. Okay, next one is read write logic. So read write logic is basically it will be providing the read write signals. So either it is right, another one is the next one is data bus buffer. So here in case of data bus buffer, it will be sending the data to the data bus. So this one is basically the data bus. The data bus, and these are control, we can call it control bus, because it is going to give the priority and it is connected with the control and the mode set register basically. So it is a control bus. These are the control bus. Okay, components will be having an address bus connected. A component need to be accessed that will be accessed by the address bus. So these are the description of here in case of 8 to 57 DRQ0 to DRQ3. Basically these are the four individual channel DMA request inputs. So these are in pin diagram we have seen D0, DRQ0, DRQ1. So basically DMA request, so external device is sending four different requests can send at a time. In that, it is basically sent by the peripheral devices for using a DMA service. So if a peripheral device want the help of a DMA controller to transfer the data, then it will be sending a request to the DMA controller, and then the DMA controller, based on the availability, it will based on the availability, it will give the permission to access the DMA controller to the buses basically, and then the data from the memory of the CPU can be transferred to the input output devices. So here, when the fixed priority mode is selected, when there is a fixed priority mode, then DRQ 0 has the highest priority and DRQ 3 has the lowest priority. So if we are going with the priority, so DRQ 0, DRQ 1, DRQ 2, okay, so this will be having highest priority, and as we will be going down, it will be having the lowest priority. So this is basically dealing with the priority. Okay, so the next four signal with respect to the DRQ is the DMA acknowledgement. Basically, so DMA is going to acknowledge, so that will be a DMA acknowledgement. So here there are active low DMA lines. Okay, so here the DMA acknowledgement lines are there. So these are the active low DMA acknowledgement lines. Basically, updates the requesting peripheral about the status of their request to the CPU. So if the external device send a request to DMA and DMA send a request to microprocessor, the request sent by the DMA by the external device to the DMA will be DMA DRQ, so DRQ 0, DRQ 1, total four different possibilities, four different signals can be sent to the DMA at a time. So with respect to this DMA request, the DMA controller will send a DRQ, that is HRQ, that is hold the request signal to the microprocessor will be acknowledging with HLDA, and once the HLDA has been acknowledgement made by the microprocessor to the DMA controller, then DMA controller will be sending back a signal to the device. Like this signal is called DACK, that is DMA acknowledgement. So DMA is sending an acknowledgement to DACK3. There are four DMA acknowledgement signals are there. So these lines can also act as strobe lines for requesting the device. So these lines basically can be working as the strobe lines for requesting the signals from the source, so that its processing can be made basically. Okay, so here it will be working as the strobe lines. Okay, for device requesting, based on the requesting, D0 to D7 are bidirectional data lines which are used to interface the system bus with the external bus of the DMA controller. So whatever external bus of system bus is there, external bus is there of 8 to 5, 7, that will be making an interface with the system bus to operate. So this bus architecture bus will be given by the data bus will be given by D0 to D7 pin. IOR is input output read. Okay, IOW is input output write. Okay, so here in case of input output read, it is an active low bidirectional tri-state input which is used by the CPU to read external registers of 8 to 5, 7 in the slave. Okay, in the slave mode, basically the registers of 8 to 5, 7 will be used basically to read the data from the CPU, that is input output read signal. Next one is input output write signal is there. Okay, so in this is also an active low bidirectional tri-state line which is used to load the content of data bus to 8-bit mode register or upper or lower byte of 16-bit DMA address register. So here we are going to write input output to the data, or from the data to the input output devices basically. So here writing data is required. So it is basically used to load. So it will be loading whatever content of the address lines are there, for the or port lines will be there, or the data from the port lines going to the source, or from the source to the input output addresses basically. Okay, so here this is used for input output related write operation. This is clock. So it is a clock having a clock signal which is required for the external operations of 8257. So whatever external operations we need to perform, then the clock of 8257 itself can be working as the clock signal. Okay, so this 8257, that is GMA controller, has its own clock signal. This is CS, that is chip select basically. So it is active low pin. If it is active low, then chip will be selected. So that we should be keeping in mind while doing the experiments. Okay. So in slave mode, so there are basically DMA controller works in two different modes, slave and master mode basically. Okay. So that slave and master mode, we will see that later into this course. Okay. So here in slave mode, it enables the read write operation to from the 8257. In the master mode, it disables the read write operation to from 8257. So in the slave mode, if it is working, this 8257 is working in slave mode, then it will be activating the input output data transfer. Okay, basically it is transfer from the memory or to the memory that is that can be performed. But in case of like it is working, this facility is being removed basically, or it is for read and write operations for the data basically. Here next is like A0 to A3. We have forgot that. So address lines basically, it is A0 to A3. That means lower four bit of data is there. So this is basically the these are the four least significant address lines. In the slave mode, they act as the input. So in the slave mode, this A0 to A3 will be working as the read. Okay. So whatever read or write operation should be performed, that will be selected based on the register, based on the address lines, that is lower address lines available. Least significant memory addresses out 8 to 5. So in slave mode, it will be working as the input lines, which basically select the registers to read and write the data. But in case of master mode, it will be basically the least significant address line. Master mode, it will be working as the is storing the data in case of read and write. A4 to A7 are the higher nibble, we call the four bits are called nibble. So it is a higher nibble of the lower byte, okay, address generated by the DMA in the master mode. So in the master mode, basically it will be the higher nibble of the 8-bit data. So this ready pin is there. So this of ready pin, it is an active high asynchronous input signal, which makes DMA ready by inserting wait states. Okay, so it is like this. First of all, this ready pin that is we have seen. Okay, so ready pin is this. So if this ready pin is given as an input to the you can say the DMA controller. So basically here, this is an active low pin. Active high pin. And this active high pin basically synchronizes the input signal that is available to the DMA controller. So in DMA controller, once this signal ready signal high, then it will make the DMA ready by inserting wait state. Okay, so if it is activated, the DMA controller will be made to wait so that the synchronization with the data transmission can be made possible. So how it is going to synchronize with the DMA controller. The next one is HRQ that we have already seen. That is hold request. Hold request will be sent to the microprocessor from the DMA controller. This HLDA is the hold acknowledgement. If DMA controller has sent the hold hold HRQ, which is hold request to the microprocessor basically. Once the DMA controller sends the signal to microprocessor, whatever request will be there. After performing its operation, the microprocessor will remove the control from the buses basically. So once it has removed the control from the buses, it will send hold acknowledgement to the DMA controller. Okay, so this is memory read. So it is the low memory read signal which is used to read the data from the address memory located locations during the read cycle. So in the memory read, it will be going to read the memory data that is during the read cycle of the DMA controller basically. Okay, so it is reading the data from the memory. Okay, the next one is memory write. So it will be like the DMA controller will be writing data to the memory from the external device. Okay, so this is ADST. So this ADST is basically we call it strobe signal. Okay, address strobe signal basically we call it. So this signal is used to convert the higher byte of the memory. So as we know, the memory is of 16 bit here. So in case of DMA controller, memory is of the channel memory has 16 bit address. Okay, so in this address, the signal, this address strobe signal basically is used to convert the higher byte of the memory. So this memory there, so it will be 8 bit, that means 1 byte, or we call it lower byte, and this is higher byte, 1 byte instruction will be memory space will be there. So this signal is basically convert the higher byte. So it will convert the higher byte of the memory address generated by the DMA controller into the latches. So whatever the higher address bytes are there in the memory, that will be converted as a latch. It will be, once it is activated, it will be sending the input data to directly to the output data. So that is the role of address adjustment, address strobe we call it, strobe signals we call it basically. AEN. So this AEN, this signal is used to disable the address and data bus. So basically it is address enable. So this is address enable. So if it is high, that means address will be enabled. If it is low, it will be working as a data bus. So this signal is basically disable the address and data bus. So as data and address bus are basically multiplexed buses, as it is multiplex, that means if it wants to work as an address, then address enable pin should be high. Okay. The next, point is TC. So this TC stands for terminal count. Okay. So basically, it indicates the present DMA cycle to the present peripheral device. So whatever this is the terminal count. So whatever the present DMA cycle is there along with the peripheral devices, whatever peripheral devices have been connected, that will be giving out the terminal count. Okay, it basically indicates present DMA cycle. So, and what particular cycle the DMA is working, that is considered given by the terminal count. This mark we have seen, if 128 byte of data have been transferred, then this will be activated. This mark pin will be activated. And this is VCC. Okay, you already know what is VCC. So up to now, this is the basics of 8257, that is DMA controller.